Hi, everybody. I'm Claudia Bester. I'm Director of Public Programs. Thank you. Welcome to the Hammer Museum. This is a really, really special night, and I think a lot of you in the audience probably have a hint of that. You might know what is in store, but I, for one, am really, really excited about tonight's program with Terry Allen and Joe Harvey Allen and Aram Moshayedi. I just want to remind you that all of the programs that we do here at the Hammer Museum are offered free to the public. Of course, that doesn't mean they actually are free. So we have a certain hard cost that goes behind them, and I think maybe after you walk out of here tonight floating on air, you'll be moved to join and support us as a member. Anyway, moving on. I'm just going to quickly introduce our amazing participants and then let them do their thing. Terry Allen is a visual artist, musician, and playwright. He received a BFA from Chouinard Art Institute in 1966. He's been awarded fellowships from the Guggenheim and the National Endowment for the Arts and was named a United States Artist Fellow. He was also inducted into the Buddy Holly Walk of Fame and was the first recipient of the Townes Van Sant Songwriting Award at the Austin Music Awards. His artwork can be found in major public collections, including the Metropolitan Museum of Art, MoMA, the Hirshhorn, LACMA, MoCA, and many others. His theater works have been performed in venues across the United States at Red Cat, the UCLA Center for the Performing Arts, the Lenzik Center for the Performing Arts, Brooklyn Academy of Music, and Mass MoCA. And his radio plays have aired on Los Angeles radio stations KPFK, KXLU, and KPCC, and broadcast nationally on NPR. As a songwriter, he's recorded 12 albums of original music, amazing music, including the seminal classic Lubbock on Everything, named one of the 50 essential albums of the 1970s by Rolling Stone magazine. In 2020, he'll release a new album titled Just Like Moby Dick, a survey of his artwork from the 60s to the present, called The Exact Moment It Happens in the West, is now on view at LA Louvre Gallery through September 28th. And Terry and his longtime partner and wife, Joe Harvey, recently performed at the awesome nightclub Zebulon here in LA in conjunction with the LA Louvre exhibition, full concert. And tonight's talk and performance is intended to focus specifically on Terry and Joe Harvey's creative work that they've produced together in theater and performance. Joe Harvey Allen is an actress, playwright, poet, and pioneer of women in radio. Perhaps best known for her numerous film roles and critically acclaimed one-woman shows, she's been praised as a storyteller in the best Texas tradition by the LA Weekly and has elicited comparisons with Flannery O'Connor, according to the New York Times. She's written and starred and toured her one-woman plays throughout the U.S. and abroad, including productions of A Moment's Hesitation at the New School in New York, Counter Angel, also at the New School, and As It Is in Texas at St. Anne's Church in New York City. Her other one-man plays include Hallie Lou, originally produced at the Aspen Museum of Art and MoCA, Duck Blind at the Coronet Theater here in LA, and Home Run in Austin, Texas. Among her many film credits are roles in David Byrne's cult classic True Stories, Fried Green Tomatoes, The Client, and Homesman. And most recently, she was nominated for Best Lead Actress by the International Film Festival of World Cinema Berlin for her role in the 2015 film The Other Kind, directed by Rosalind Rosen. From 1967 to 1971, she hosted the weekly radio show Rawhide and Roses on KPCC, making her the first female country music DJ in the United States. And you can hear it online. Some of the remaining recordings have been archived online, and they're amazing. Terry and Joe Harvey Allen are both natives of Lubbock, Texas, and have been married for 57 years. Since the 1970s, they've collaborated and performed together in over two dozen theatrical productions for the stage and radio. They live and work in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and Austin, Texas. And tonight, the Hammer's own curator, Aram Moshayedi, will be moderating this dialogue and performance. So please join me in welcoming Aram Moshayedi, Terry Allen, and Joe Harvey Allen.
Thank you. It is 1957. He is at the kitchen window. She's been gone for 3 days. He never knew what to do, so he just waited. He knew she was probably out drinking. The piano in the living room was not enough. He understood it. She was a lot younger than him, but he still had the feeling, so he waited.
Stand in the kitchen, stand in the hall, make you stand in the bedroom, stand against the wall. But you better hold on, you better hold on to the house. Yes, stand.
It's 1958. They've been together longer than they were ever with anyone else. They lay in separate beds and talk about their lives. And the stories come up one by one. And great spaces open up and move in and out between them. She says a person has to dig into the heart of everything. And all that gets dug out, what little of it is all there is or ever will be. He says he remembers every game. She says she remembers every song. Suddenly, it's not just about the two of them. It's all of it, most of which can never be said. It just lays there in the dark, like the black gap between the two beds that holds their hands. It has nothing to do with growing old.
Hey, Missouri born, redleg boy, he just born here to play in the ball. Ain't much good for much else at all. He just born here to play in the ball. I'll run from home, he couldn't wait. Hold his ground here behind the plate. Hit the ball, you're on your own. Same damn thing you try to get back home. Missouri born, red leg boy. He just born here to play in the ball. Ain't much good for much else at all. He just born here to play in the ball.
stuck a pencil through the batter's tongue during the bottom of the eighth. The batter got beaned in the Adam's apple. He was having a convulsion and trying to swallow his own tongue. While the other players held him down, he grabbed the umpire's yellow scoring pencil and shoved it straight through to the other side. It didn't work. The batter passed right there in the box, purple as a turnip. Both clubs stood around a while looking at him. Then two of the teammates put dimes in his eyes and carried him off and laid him under a quilt behind the concession. Then they finished the game.
He lived his life moving around, playing the ball head from town to town. Saw everything that he wanted to see, weren't nothing else that he wanted to be. Missouri born, redneck boy, he just born here to play the ball. Ain't much good for much else at all, he just born here to play the ball.
The next day, they played a doubleheader up in Mobile, then took the night train back to Houston. He was 46 years old, and he hurt all over, and it was 1932. And he would never play ball again. That pink tongue had did it. He was hanging up the spikes.
Oh, got too old to play the ball. Settled down, but remembered it all. Lived it out till it died. Cussing the Yankees all satisfied. Missouri born, redneck boy. He just born here to play in the ball. Ain't much good for much else at all. He just born here to play in the ball. Woo.
He is cussing the Yankees. It's the final game of the World Series. He's cussing the television. He cusses the players. All they care about's the money. The pitcher takes forever to throw the damn ball. She can hear him in the kitchen. She pours a small whiskey. The Yankees win. The television is off. The game is over. He's 73 years old. She comes in and takes his hand. It's time. Her fingers move lightly over his big knuckles like she's playing the piano. He feels himself suddenly come loose and fly out in a great high and familiar arc. And in some infinite and secret place, she flies away with him. Hi, y'all.
Thank you both so much. I have to say that it's a great honor to share a stage with you, but I'm reminded of my talentlessness. It's kind of amazing to be as close to the performance as I am. So, and play a small part in some way. But we're gonna have a couple of kind of interludes of conversation between music. And I thought maybe what we could do is just to give a bit of context, because we're specifically kind of organized this around a few specific works. To maybe one point of clarification is that, you know, importantly, they're not collaborative works in any way, but they are examples of moments in your kind of individual histories where you've come together on various projects, whether it's Joe Harvey as a performer or a voice in some cases. But specifically to start with this piece, Dugout, which is an excerpt that you just performed. It's I think in a characteristic way of many of these pieces is they're multi-dimensional and multi-form. So how we're even experiencing it now is probably perhaps like a kind of extension of that in some ways, knowing that they in some cases begin as installations or take on another life as a theater piece, have drawings and other objects or sculptural works that make up the many parts of Dugout as well. But maybe specifically if you could you know, talk about Dugout as it relates to your, you know, the family history that is, seems to be evoked by the narrative of the of the lyrics and of the story.
Yeah, Dugout is based on my parents. And my dad was a professional ball player, and my mother was a professional piano player. And my dad was 60 when I was born, so he was born in 1886. And his dad fought in the Civil War, so that was my granddad. So it was a very close kind of history. But both of my parents were kind of incredible storytellers. And I grew up hearing these incredible stories about baseball and about music and about the lives of these two people who had pretty much gone, lived their lives by the time I came along, what they loved to do. My mother quit. I think I played, or she played her last gig when I was about 6 years old. My dad was 60 when I was born, so he had quit playing baseball, but he always considered himself a baseball player. But anyway, I heard all of these stories, and I got asked to do a radio show by New American Radio, and I was always interested in how you told stories and how they changed and how they told stories and these stories changed. And I wanted to do something with them with radio. And so I started writing them all down, and then I put them in kind of a narrative and made it the story of this man and woman from the time that they were born to the time they met each other until he passed away. So it's like all of the stories are probably lies, you know, because they were, you know, they had no problem lying like dogs, all of, you know. But there was a through line that kind of went through them that that was our life, and that's what Dugout really became. It became this started out being a radio show telling these stories, and then kind of developed into a whole body of visual works, a couple of installations, and a theater piece. And then I got really interested in what was happening to me at the time that these stories were happening, what my stories were. And so I did a whole other body of work called War Boy, and that was a theater piece. So it all together, it was under this, you know, idea of Dugout. My mother was born in a dugout in Oklahoma. My dad spent a lot of time in dugouts playing baseball, so that's where the that was the connector. and he played. He went up to the majors in 1910, and played for the St. Louis Browns, and then spent the rest of his life playing in Texas League, player manager.
I have to say, Terry came from a very colorful family. And I thought when he started writing about his family, he might be going to have a nervous breakdown. And it scared just the hell out of me. But everything that was too crazy for print, he turned into the sweetest stories. I was very happy.
And that was the piece is, it begins in kind of, I mean, you started working on it in the mid-90s, is that right?
Yeah, the radio show, I think, was in early 90s, whatever.
So, I mean,
something like that.
Before we get kind of too far ahead, though, I did think it would be important to kind of go back maybe to the late 60s and Joe Harvey specifically, because I think radio comes up so much in these works as, you know, being conceived as audio pieces for the radio, which is, you know, fascinating that you're thinking about that arena for this work, but knowing what we also know about Joe Harvey's experience with radio, you know, starting in 1967 with Rawhide and Roses, I wanted, I mean, I read a review of Dugout where the writer Malik Gaines says the most consistent element of Terry Allen's multi-part, multimedia invasion of Los Angeles is the quirky and thoroughly charming voice of his wife, performer Joe Harvey Allen, whose Texas twang spits forth like dirt clods in a slingshot.
I never heard that.
I couldn't have said it better myself.
Oh, come on.
So, I mean, Joe Harvey, I think because it is such a signature of your character, and this kind of lends itself so well to the radio. Maybe just if you could talk about the kind of your earliest experiences with radio and maybe how it kind of led to then your role in later pieces with Terry.
Well, you know, we just had two little boys, Buck and Bale, that's really the only thing I ever really knew I wanted to do was have kids, and so I was very happy at home, and Terry walked in one day and said, well, are you going to go back to work again, or, you know, what? And I just, like, made it up on the spot. I said, oh, yeah, I'm going to radio school. It never occurred to me in a million years. I never even knew there was a radio school. And the next day, Terry walks in the door. He says, are you still going to radio school? And I go, oh, yeah, I am. And he said, well, I got you a radio show. I get a lot off of Terry. I mean, Claudia said something. I forget what it was because it just goes by me. I just take them all in, you know. I got one review here in L.A. that I was a film director. I loved that. So, anyway, you know, I'm very happy with that situation. So, Terry said, well, the first one is going to be... we will tape it, but the second one will be live. And so I went, it was KPPC, and fortunately it was the first underground rock station in the whole country, and you could actually say fuck on the air. So everybody says it, you know, but then everybody was glued to it, so it became a really popular show. And so it was wonderful because it was in the basement of the First Presbyterian Church in Pasadena. And we did it early in the morning, and it was all the rock and country people came. And then after that was Bernie Pearl's blues show. So B.B. King, all the great blues players came. Everybody wanted to come, you know, because they could say anything. And then after that was live Fire Sign Theater. So that was the 60s. So it was really fun.
Yeah, and the Holy Modal Rounders were the Fire Sign Theater's house band at that time.
Yeah.
And I think Sam Shepard was playing drums for them. It was kind of a, you know, everybody was kind of pushing their first records and pushing their records. So we had these interviews and these people came out. And it was literally no one would leave once you got there. That, you know, people wanted to see Bernie Pearl's show and then Bernie Pearl, all those people wanted to see the Fire Sign Theater. So it was a huge crowd in this little studio by the time the day was over, you know. I programmed the music, and Joe Harvey talked. The shows were like theme shows, like we'd do one about, you know, illicit love, dogs, you know, trucks, you know, just kind of whatever popped up that week.
And my relatives.
Yeah, well, it didn't matter what the show was about. Joe Harvey, all she talked about were her relatives. Yeah, I love it. So. It was a very artful show.
So, one of the things that you said yesterday, Terry, when we were talking, you said that Joe Harvey has always been the voice of your theater pieces, which yeah. I think you meant it also in just a very straightforward way that, you know, her voice that's dirt clod and a slingshot has always been kind of an integral part of the work. But I also kind of took it to mean something much more. And I think it would be a good time to maybe just talk about the nature of your creative relationship, in addition to how you've kind of had such an incredible, you know.
It's the one advantage of having an actor in the house, you know, is that you can throw ideas off of them. And Jo Harvey, kind of early on, I realized that she could shift personas, like almost in the middle of a sentence. She could, you know, she did that at the kitchen table too, you know. Anyway,
it's necessary.
When I wrote these pieces, I always heard her voice, because most of the pieces initially, especially, were about family and were about friends that kind of came out of a biographic fiction of these people. And Jo Harvey knew all of these very same people and knew these same stories, that because we've known each other since we were 11 years old. So, and these people that we grew up and were, you know, that I ended up writing things about and doing things about, she was kind of the perfect foil and perfect voice of those, not only in terms of performing it, but also in just talking out, developing it and whatever. So we always, you know, Jo Harvey has always acted in the pieces that I did. And then, so we'd work for each other. She would work for me as an actor. I would work for her. I'd write songs or do sets or whatever. But the only time that, you know, life was really a living hell was when we collaborated, you know. And because we were both so cold-blooded with one another when it comes to making something, we tried to be so as honest with each other. And when it came right down to it, no one would ever be as honest, as Jo Harvey, as far as my writing or whatever. And it always pissed me off, you know. But I come back and realize that there was something absolutely true about it, and to consider. And I think that it was mutual.
Yeah, you know? Vice versa. The first time I showed Terry, I'd written the first chapter of a book, and he said, "Well, that's great. Now start over." And I did.
The one thing that I'll say before, maybe then we'll go on to another, is just that this idea of living with an actress and having to kind of deal with the character aspect. It's one of the anecdotes from David Byrne about
the lying woman.
Going back
that
to
was her character,
right? And when he approached Jo Harvey, he said that, you know, he asked if she'd be interested in playing a part in True Stories, and she said, "I'll play all of them."
No. He didn't say that. He said, "You could play all of these parts." I thought he meant it. And I put a lot of work into that. And I went to New York with just one goal in mind, because I'd nailed all the other parts, I thought. And I was trying to convince him that I could also play the male parts, because I can look exactly like a man when I put, hair oil and part my hair and all that stuff. And so he didn't like that. But he did promise me. He said, "You can pick one part," but he said, "In the next movie, you can play all the parts." So he sent me a script later on of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. He's the liar.
Should we do memoirs?
Yeah, we go to tattoo.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, this is from Memoirs, which is a piece that's up at Louvre right now, a video piece. But I think it was written to be performed audially, but also possibly could be performed live. And It's a little section about my uncles who were very heavily tattooed. They were all Navy people on my mother's side of the family. And I think like a lot of people from the panhandle of Texas, which is just flat as death, you know, in every direction. I think it was that horizon that drew, like a lot of people that were enlisted in the service, enlisted in the Navy, because I think there was a comfort to that horizon. And anyway, my uncles would, they were, like I said, they were heavily tattooed. I had one uncle that had a longhorn steer tattooed on his chest, and the eyes were about where the nipples were. And then the nose, there were rabbits that came running out and made a belt around his running. And the horns of the steer tipped at the ends of his wrists. So when he did that, it was just longhorns. And I remember it was beautiful. And it was done in somewhere like the Philippines with bamboo, tattoo. So anyway, this is a little thing about them. In the summer of the late 40s and early 50s, whenever there was a family gathering, the whole bunch would take chairs and wash tubs full of ice-down beer out into whatever yard was there, put meat and roast ears on the fire, strip down to their skivvies, and sit around sunning themselves. They'd smoke, drink icy bottles of beer and whiskey in paper cups, and tell what was surely outrageous lies about various naval battles and loose foreign women, sing bawdy sea ballads, and each try to outdo the other by showing off their heavily tattooed bodies.
From the time you could barely crawl, you would sit in the dirt beneath their feet and gaze transfixed at them, mesmerized by the pictures on their skin, and trace these fantastic images slowly with your fingertips, imprinting them in your memory. Panthers, birds, naked hula girls, angels, the Rock of Ages, longhorn steers with rabbits running out their noses, raging bulls, Satan snorting fire, monkeys, Jesus, snakes, skulls, and hearts wrapped in curly banners saying Mom or Joy or Remember Pearl. Some etched with machines and others hand-hammered with bamboo sticks and needles. Wondrous drawings from mysterious ports in exotic countries all over the world, scrawled across their arms and their bellies and their chests, their throats, backs, and legs. The history of their lives in ink. And you as a child loving it. Absolutely enchanted, just looking at and touching those living pictures on the flesh.
I didn't know it at the time, but that experience, along with the clutch of Tales from the Crypt, Mad Magazine, and classic comic books stashed under my bed, and finding a couple of Tijuana Bibles in my dad's sock drawer, were my first deep seduction into the true passions of the visual arts.
Crazy too.
something's made me crazy, babe. Maybe something made you crazy too. I'm just sailing out on the ocean, babe, trying to find America with you. Yo ho ho. Yo ho ho. Here we go. Yo ho ho. I'm trying to find. Trying to find America with you. Trying to find America with you.
When your cousin finally came back from the war, he lived in a trailer out on the flats north of Amarillo. His feet were shot up. His family had been killed in a head-on collision with a drunk, and the war had murdered his soul. When he found out about his family, he was in a firefight in the jungle near the Coochee tunnels just out of Saigon. Someone tapped him on the shoulder and told him that he had an emergency call and was ordered to get back to the rear fast. Less than 24 hours later, he was in Amarillo, standing in ice on a cement porch in the middle of a blue norther, looking at the front door of an empty house. His little girl, his wife, and her Jody boyfriend were killed outright. He said the little girl was decapitated. His little boy was critical, but would survive with a withered arm, bad temper, and a future in one penitentiary after another. Your cousin went back to finish his first tour and then did two more and deserted in the middle of the last one.
I walked outside with him. He had a heavy bow and leather quiver full of arrows. It was 110 degrees and we were smoking dope and drinking beer. The horizon was dead flat and shimmering with heat. One old dog was under the trailer and its heavy breath was the only thing you could hear. A large straw stuffed target was set up about 50 feet away. He limped over to a worn spot in the dirt and settled himself facing the target. I stood back and over to the side. He pulled an arrow out, stuck the bowstring in the notch, raised it up, pulled back and aimed. I watched his face. It was the emptiest thing I ever saw. He shot the arrow and it hit the target. He noticed and shot another one. It's ancient, he said. Old as fucking Asia. Every time I let it go, something a whole lot deeper and older gets let go. I always feel better. Then he shot several more, very deliberate and cold as ice, all stuck close together near the center of the target. I might go compete professional. I think I might have been meant to do this shit since the day I was born. But he wouldn't. Over the years, his latest wife would call and say, well, he's gone again. He'd become what is called a tripwire vet. He'd quit whatever job he had and go off into some deep wilderness armed to the teeth with several of his vet buddies for months at a time. They'd try to get as far away from humanity as they could, do a lot of drugs, and live like they lived over there. It never panned out very well. My cousin died in the 90s. And New Year's Eve outside of Tacoma.
Thank you.
remember all those psychedelic nights when your head come loose and floated into the light, and all them girls without any tops at all down in the dirt. After the fall, yeah, remember how all the fantasies worked. The little flags in front of the track homes by the church. It's a wonder anything's left to hurt at all down in the dirt. After the fall. Yeah, remember the flower children and their shit-eating grins, wearing buckskin, building teepees, trying to be Indians. And remember the reservation with the drunks against the wall, peddling turquoise to the tourists down in the dirt. After the fall. Inside their armored cars. Saw it all on TV while we ate just what we saw, so we too could partake in history without our names being on the wall or down in the dirt. After the fall. Psychedelic night when your head come loose and floated into the light, and all them girls without any tops at all down in the dirt. After the fall. After the fall.
It's interesting that the order, I mean, it's obviously quite deliberate, but hadn't really noticed before that, you know, with Dugout, there is something of a kind of through line that connects maybe the Civil War to the kind of like post-World War II era in American history, and then especially the anecdote about your own story and kind of main impetus behind this work by Moore has a lot to do with your cousin's experience after the war, and just, which leads me, or after the Vietnam War, leads me to the question of how, you know, these personal experiences within your own kind of family history become such an important part of your work. And because there is, obviously you're working in a number of different formats, that this question of storytelling comes up a lot, and how you're able to then translate, you know, lived experience into story, and why that form is so important for you.
Well, I think it's, you know, work comes from the things that affect you, that affect your life, that mean something to you. And I think for my generation, I know that being in LA all of the 60s, where everything was kind of changing, all of the isms were collapsing or merging or whatever, art-wise, but also music was every bit as much a volatile form of expression, I think, as anything. And at least it was for me. And I don't. Regarding the war, it's you know, if you're dealing with stories and you're dealing with time and you're dealing with America, then you're dealing with a war because there's always one going on, you know. And so, I like memoirs, I just kind of thought about, started thinking about all of these connections and these over, you know, long periods of time with my family and how certain wars were affecting their lives and affecting everybody's lives. So they became, I know when I dealt very personally with my cousin, I never made the connection that what was happening with him, it was like something that was happening in your family, but it was the same thing that was happening to the whole country. It was collapsing in that way, or it was being damaged in that particular kind of way. And I started thinking about just the aftermath of the war and the people I knew and some whatever, and started making pieces and writing songs. And then I got invited to Thailand by a German film company to do the soundtrack for a film on called Amerasia, about Amerasian kids coming from Vietnam to Thailand because it was kind of a safe zone. And so I worked with a Thai band, and I was kind of the translator for that film company with these American vets that were expatriates in Thailand. So that, all of that information, I think, just kind of kept propelling this body of work, which I did on pretty much all through the 80s. I did a lot of other works, too, during that period of time, but that was kind of a consistent thing that until I just got so, I realized there was no ending to it, and it just didn't end, and so I just stopped doing it. But that's kind of where that was, what that was about.
And Joe Harvey, I mean, to a kind of similar end, you recently referred to yourself as a documentarian of a certain kind as well, and I feel like so much of what you've tried to do also is translate real life into kind of story in some way. So wondering if you can also talk about that aspect to your work.
Well, the first piece I did was really autobiographical, but it was all based on poems. So it was a poetry performance. But I think after that, I started interviewing people at Terry's suggestion. I'd gone to, continuing the radio thing, I'd gone to the Willie Nelson thing to interview Waylon Jennings. And I'm talking to Waylon, and he said, "Oh God, I gotta go. You know, we're having a really nice time talking." And he said, "I gotta go do this interview." So I just didn't show up. And so
the
interview
was supposed to be with you.
Yeah, with me. Right. So I didn't go. And so I was miserable about that. And we were at a restaurant in Lubbock, and Terry said, "You know, why do you always have to talk to people that are famous anyway? Why don't you interview this waitress?" So I asked if I could go to her house. And when I got to her house, she was real bubbly at the cafe. But when I got to her house, I sat there with her two little children, and they had waited and waited. We waited for hours for her to get home from work, and they had only eaten French fries from McDonald's. They'd borrowed 15 cents from a neighbor. And she came home with a bloody eye, and then I started talking to her, and I just got so involved in how she could ever get out of this hole that she was in that it started a book first, and then the book became a play based on all these women that I traveled around for several years interviewing waitresses. And that sort of setup, I did it first in truck stops, and first I did it at the Chicken Burger Cafe in Anchorage, Alaska. And so I had real people in the restaurant, in the cafe, plus people that knew it was a play, and it was all scripted. But it set up doing performances in the real location based on real people, and so I sort of all my work became known as that I was really documenting characters, and the plays were word for word, these composites of these characters. And so I think that was sort of the identity of my work for a very long time.
Well, Joe Harvey, we get information like very different. Like if we're sitting in a cafe and in a booth and I'm listening, I'm suddenly hear something I'm interested in, some people behind me, then that's how I get information. Joe Harvey, if she's sitting down and she hears somebody talking that she gets, she just gets up and goes and sits with them, you know. So it's two different ways of figuring stuff out, I guess.
Another interesting thing is that I'll say, Terry, you know, you can't see them, but the people right behind you, they're incredible. You know, they're just this and that. And Terry will say, yeah, and the people right behind you just threw up on their table or something. You know, I mean, it's like, we're seeing different stuff.
It's appropriate to talk about, I think, especially in relationship to memoirs, because as the installation of memoirs is one of the most kind of like, endearing aspects of it is that you're both facing each other and you kind of look at each other as you're reciting these passages. I kind of thought about it as I watched, you know, Terry, you play, and Joe Harvey, you look along lovingly at Terry, which... is such an important part of the installation as well, that you're both kind of playing off of each other in a certain way. And I wondered, I know that it doesn't necessarily correspond, but I also know that recently you've been part of this big kind of archival project, getting your archive ready, and it's now at Texas Tech and everything like that. And so that already in itself must carry with it a lot of kind of retrospective kind of thinking and looking back at your own personal histories and how much memoirs also, you know, deals with that in such a direct way.
Just crawling down memory lane.
Right. Right. Yeah. And does that inform the work in some way, or that experience of kind of processing your lives in this way that it'll have now a kind of archival...
It makes you want to run away from it and do something new.
Yeah. Well, it does. There's been like all these reissues of records and then dealing with the archives, which has been an 8-year kind of process. And then these pieces. And then the show that Louvre's put together, which is a survey of work from the 60s to the present. I really was ready to move on. I cut a new record last May and wrote all new songs for it and been performing those songs. Of course, by the thing with cutting a record, that by the time it's released, all those new songs are so old you can't stand them anymore. You play it, you know, so many times. But I think both of us are kind of chomping at the bit to make new pieces and so forth. But I think it's also there's something inevitable that you reach our age and you think back, you know, you think back on your life, you think back what you've done, you think about, you know, what you still want to do, and so, you know, it's you're just kind of whistling through the graveyard, you know.
At least. See? Not me.
In the process of this, looking back, and you mentioned the reissues of the albums on Bachelors of Paradise.
Yeah.
And then in the context of the show at LA Louvre, you know, which I feel in some ways as an extension, that this program can kind of shed light on another side of your respective works. But one of the things that's so apparent in that Louvre show is the connection between music and visual art. And it's also apparent also in the reissues. And I wondered maybe just to talk about these kind of different cultural arenas and how you've had to kind of bounce back and forth, you know, in very real ways sometimes, that they have very different, you know, protocols and
yeah, rituals. It's always kind of a generality has been that, you know, you deal with a record company in the past anyway for me, and they would say, oh, well, you know, I like this music, but what's this art shit, you know? And then you go talk to some gallery person, and you get the same thing, you know? What's this music shit, you know? And so I realized early on kind of that was an attitude that was prevalent in, with a lot of these institutions. I don't think artists or musicians I ever felt that way. I never felt that kind of thing coming from friends or, you know, whether musician, artist, whatever. I don't know, I always thought of it as one thing. And even when I was in junior high school, I was telling you the other day, I used to keep a little journal and I would put, I want to be an artist, a musician, a writer. And then the next time I'd write, I want to be a writer, a musician, an artist. And then a musician, a writer, or an artist, and a writer. So it kind of from early on, you know, I managed to confuse myself. <You know? laughs> But I also think that, for me, it is totally one thing. It's never been making a painting or a sculpture or an installation or whatever. It was never any more important than writing or meant anything or value than writing just a little country song, I think, or writing a song, period. So I don't think in those kind of terms that there's a high art, a low art, or whatever. It's just what you do. It's what you make and what your necessity is to do something. I always thought of it, too, like your senses. You've got, like, five senses at least. And you somehow manage to smell, hear, feel, taste, whatever, all of those senses at once. You can do it all at once without just falling over, you know. And you usually don't get up in the morning and say, today I'm only gonna smell things. I'm just gonna smell. It's kind of... So to me, it's fuller if you kind of use whatever you've got, you know, to use.
And Joe Harvey, I mean, would it be applicable to say the same about performance and thinking about, you know, performance within an art context versus theater versus television versus film, and how you've managed to kind of move fluidly between all of those?
Yeah, every one of them is different, though. I don't know. It was the same play to do it in a truck stop or honky tonk and then do it, you know, or to do a revival preacher by the side of the road or to do it in the theater. And it just seems like natural. Same, you know, it's whatever comes around, you know.
It's a lot of times, I think it's the context that you do it, too. It's like I've been in those situations where I'll play a club one night and with a band and a set list. And then the next night, I'll play a concert in a museum, same band, same set list, you know. And
better or worse acoustics in the museum.
Well, it's not even that. It's like in a club, it's direct. People, you know, directly respond to the music. They just respond. They either dance, they'll sing along, they'll do whatever, but they respond to what's happening. In an art kind of context, It's much more people sitting back thinking, what should I think about this? And by the time they figure out what they're supposed to think about, it's over, you know?
Should we do Ghost Ship?
Huh?
Ghost Ship?
Yeah. Yeah, Ghost Ship, it's a body of work and theater piece about Antonin Artaud, the visionary artist, poet, and playwright, who had a huge, influence on American theater, contemporary American theater, living theater, Sam Shepard, Patti Smith, the whole generation kind of, I think, was informed by what he did. And I came across him when I was in Chouinard. I was up in San Francisco at City Lights Bookstore, and that was when Ferlinghetti was actually the kind of ran the bookstore and worked behind the counter. And I remember seeing this book that with this face on it, and it was like so compelling. I picked up the book and I started looking at it, and I had this series of these incredible haunted faces and drawings and kind of portraits, self-portraits. I took it up to the counter, and I remember telling Ferlinghetti, I said, I have no money, but I really have to have this book. And he looked at me and he just said, take the fucker. And so I took it. And I later found out it was Antonin Artaud, and it was the first kind of English translation that Jack Hirschfield had put together of an anthology of his writings. And over the years, I was always interested in what he did and read most of the stuff that I could. But when we performed Dugout in Houston, the French Alliance of Houston actually approached me and asked me if I would do a piece. They'd like for me to write a piece do it in Lyon at this big theater workshop they have there. And so I was very excited about the possibility of doing that. And the first thing I thought is I want to do a piece about Artaud, and which is eventually what I did. There's also a sculpture piece called Ghost Ship Rodez and Momo Lo Mismo, which is over at the warehouse at Louvre. But anyway, we're getting ready to do, we'll do some excerpts from that play.
It is so beautiful here, so absolutely uncontrollable. On the mountain, a green garden, stair-stepped with rock walls winding around pots of flowers, cactus and old vine-covered trees. A soft, dry breeze drifts through the vague, soggy light, and a tiny nativity is enclosed inside a black burnout hearth. So surely, the sweet baby Jesus breathes his impossible secret into every crannied nook. The house is perfect blue. But the beautiful mountain disappears under dark green clouds, crackling and falling apart with lightning. And a new mountain rises from the choking dust, broken away from all that's natural, under ugly, cloudless brown skies. Desert, the red place. It's absolutely uncontrollable. Artaud knew the power of his face. He did numerous self-portraits during his life, but none as amazing and terrifying as those he made while institutionalized in Rodez. He made himself over and over, just himself, inside, outside, wrong side under. He made every place he never was. He drew demon beings who came out at night, but all the images were of himself. He was a beautiful young man. He was handsome as a movie star. He stared at himself in the mirror and would scream and scream for hours. In 1936, addicted to heroin, jaundiced from the infernal deluge of his own language, upset at the public failure of his radical theater ideas, he sought a fresh perspective on the nature of magic and the condition of the world. He got a haircut and went to Mexico.
Do they dream of hell and heaven? Are they restless with their reward? Does God spend time with his angels, or does he show them no regard?
Secured a lecture for him at the Children's Teatro. His subject was the idiocy of communism and genitalia. He thought it went very well. He used the lecture money to buy blank paper and codeine.
Something strange about heaven. They just don't want you to know. Do they dream of hell in heaven? Before life on this sweet earth was done. And the golden gates of forever close tight on all the fun. Yeah, the golden gates of forever close tight.
Later, he fell down and couldn't get up. Mandu, he cried, but he couldn't get up. A teenage passerby kicked him in the head. He woke up filthy in an infirmary. On the street outside, a violin was playing. Weeks later, after securing a loan from the one wealthy French patron who still had confidence in him, he left Mexico City. Suffering severe headaches and in morphine withdrawal, he traveled north on horseback into the deserts of Chihuahua to the land of the Tahamara. His Indian guide was frightened of him. He thought he was El Brujo, the witch man. He found a staff there, and he believed it to be the staff of St. George or the staff of Jesus. And in his madness, he traveled to Ireland to give it back to the Irish people. Upon his return from Ireland to France, Artaud spent the rest of his life in various mental institutions, one being Rodez, where he received over 50 electroshock treatments. It would also be one of his most productive periods as an artist and a writer. Artaud died of intestinal cancer in 1948. He was found by a gardener in his small quarters clutching a shoe. The staff of St. George, the staff of Jesus, was never recovered. So he traveled from the red place into the mysterious world, grasping to take everything. Oh, but it is so beautiful here. So dangerous with life. So full. And so absolutely uncontrollable.
So, Joe Harvey, you said yesterday that that this was a particularly difficult role to play, and I think in part because in a characteristic fashion there are also many voices and many characters, but it's all kind of circulating around the figure of Artaud, yeah. And in some way you're getting into the mind of him. And it's a two-part question, just again about the kind of your willingness to be a conspirator in Terry's, you know, projects in that way, but then also if you can just talk about that the difficulty of performing in such a way that you have to kind of move through voices or personalities or kind of narratives that are also so tied up within knots, within itself, yeah. And within a single piece.
Well, I've always really been honored to be in Terry's pieces. Terry, I love Terry's writing. I've loved his plays. And really happy always to be in those pieces. But when he brought me, we were on our way to France. We were literally leaving the next few days. He was writing the play right up until the last minute, and he brought it to me. And I was in the living room, and he gave it to me, and then he walked out to his studio. And when he came back, I said, well, I trust you. But I hated it. I hated it. And he knew I hated it, but we were on our way to perform it. And when I got to France, I just could not do the play. It was so vile. And I mean, seriously vile. And well, he was quite mad, Artaud. And I was to play not only Artaud, but all of his mother and all the demons in his head. They're called the daughters of the heart to be born. And I didn't want they were grown men by then. I still didn't want them to hear me saying these things. And I just didn't want to do it. And so I couldn't learn it at all. I shouldn't even tell this. It's kind of long, huh? But anyway.
Yeah, don't tell it.
Well, I'm telling it anyway. I was actually, for real, gonna feign a heart attack because I didn't think that I thought Terry would divorce me if we got to France and I didn't do the play. And so, but a miracle happened, and a real miracle happened. And I walked out and called everybody to come down from the, you know, they, most of them spoke French. They really didn't understand me, probably for the better. But I told them, now I understood this play, and I was going to just really play all the demons that haunted Arto. And when this thing happened to me, I just had this thing with Arto in my head, and I said, I get it now, and all the suffering that you endured. He was brilliant. He was just brilliant. And everybody hated him, and the French hated him, and all of his friends hated him. And but I said, I'm going to play these characters. It's just like a son of a bitch, really, because that's what you endured. And I just made friends with Arto, and it was so redeeming. The last part of the play was so redeeming that someone just asked me, they said, well, what was your favorite thing you ever did in anything you ever did? And I was at a classroom, and I just burst into tears. And I said, the last scene of Terry's play about Arto.
And Terry, was it similar for you, kind of getting in the mind of Arto in that way?
Yeah, I mean, it was hard to write, but it was, he was so many different people. There were so many different aspects of him, as far as his, not only his language, but his writing, his addictions, his attitudes about women, everything was off kilter in a kind of odd way. And he was a film star. He was a movie star, and he was in that famous film Napoleon, and played Marat. And there's that great scene of him, Charlotte Corday, stabbing him in the bathtub, and. I don't know, all of those images, which I think it kind of culminated interest in just in theater, in terms of the living theater. When Joe Harvey and I first saw that, what an incredible impact it had on us. And I just think that the fact that he wanted to take everything to its extreme, to its limit, whether it was language, whether it was... life, just life, everything, every way he lived was pushed to the absolute max. And I just, you know, I became very interested in him when I wrote this piece.
It's interesting the contrast between the extremity of Arto on the one hand, but then also the smoothness of both the music, but then also of Joe Harvey's voice, that there's something that's quite soft, like softens it, I think.
But not every scene in that play was
right.
Like that.
Well, it was an odd thing too, because at the time it was when Bush was doing freedom fries, you know, instead of French fries, and we were coming from the Houston French Connection was where the money came from the piece. So the French people, when they heard that French fries were being called freedom fries, thought it was hilarious, you know, but I know the reviews, which we were nervous about doing the play in front of a total French audience that most of them did not know English, and they were very concerned about it. The theater was concerned about it, so they brought in a guy, an American who had lived in France for years and directed a lot of Beckett plays and worked with a lot of French writers and English writers, but he came and he talked to the audience. We did a special performance for him. He really liked the piece, and each night before we performed, he would meet with the audience about 30 minutes and talk to them about kind of the key points of the piece and what was going on with it. And I think that helped them, because it was really very well received. They said, one review I said, thanks, that it took two people from Bush country to bring us back Arto, And so it was an odd kind of, you know, collision.
And then they started to honor him, you know, in France.
I think maybe for the sake of time, we might round it out with.
Yeah, we got one more from a piece called Covenant, which is a piece that we wrote together. This is just the tail end of it.
Terry and I'd have a date, and he'd knock on the door, and he'd say, run, they're after us, run for our lives. We'd just head out the door, run and slam the doors and peel out and hide in the shopping center and the cotton fields all night long, just running from them, you know, running and hiding. We're still running from the son of a bitches. You don't want to play your song.
This song starts off about 1956. Dance. And I was with Myrtis Murphy, the girl with the snapping turtle spine. You'd be dancing with old Myrtis and two bones would come out and nearly break your finger off. Joe Harvey was with Freddie Lowe, Fat Freddie we called him. It was that dance I met Joe Harvey. I remember standing all scrubbed down and clean, kicking my foot at the record machine. I was watching you dancing, watching you prancing, noticed you glancing at me. So I took my first chance and I asked you to dance. And we touched the first time with a song flying by. When the blue of your eyes met my blues down inside, well, I knew that we two could fly. Through 30 years of storms and the rains, 30 years of the fear. 30 years to be accused and to blame. Oh, 30 years don't mean a thing when you put them aside. Them good songs we sang.
shuck some corn. When the stalks break off, the husks skinned, the silk gone, the ear boiled. Gobble and gnaw and suck it raw till there's just a cob, no more. Shuck off my mama and my daddy, my lover, my babies, and my grandbabies, and all my friends. All you've taught me. Strip off the silks one by one, and what would be left is a secret. I remember sleeping down in this basement when I was 5 years old, and it was a really hot night. And I started just praying and praying for snow. And I woke to a white morning with almost enough faith for a whole lifetime.
Oh, my mother, she is a mountain, and her breast, it touched the sky. And my father, he is a river running through her sweet by and by. And my sister, she is a songbird, and she's singing in her flight. And my brother, he is a moonbeam falling on her in the night. There is a river run through the mountain under moonlight. Hear the song of the bloodlines gone long before me and ever after. Moving on, ever after, moving on.
So we have a bit of time for some questions. There are two ushers that'll come down, and we unfortunately, it's not in our control at all which one of you gets picked. Questions, so I'll try to get their attention. But
that was beautiful.
Hi, how are you? I had occasion today to listen to Dugout at L.A. Louvre. It was not the Dugout that you performed tonight. It was quite dark, about a cave and a baby. Could you illuminate on that particular piece?
A cave and a baby?
I think it was a cave. Well, you called it a dugout. And it was about a little baby that I think got killed.
Are you sure you went to my show?
I did. Yes, it was around the corner, the first corner.
Yeah, I really don't know. Cave and a baby.
Yeah, about you, your Aram? Mother being born. Yes, yeah. Exactly.
What?
About your mother.
A dugout is it's half in and half out the side of a hill. The story, there's the way the structure of the first part of the piece is that there are these set pieces or stages, and each have six drawings that carry the narrative. And there's six of those. So that's kind of the very first line that you hear when you're talking about. I assume that's what you're talking about. But it goes on and on and on and on. It doesn't just stop at the cave and the baby. You know?
Listening to a lot of your music on the way down from Santa Barbara, on the way here, and we were wondering about the New Delhi freight train, and were you there in India? And the other question we had was truckload of art.
Mm.
With what happened on the five today, it was like that came up, a truckload of gasoline fell over on the 5 and caused gridlock all through Los Angeles today. Well, nothing exploded, as far as we know. Anyway, so where did you get the idea for truckload of art? I know back in the 70s there was a lot of consternation on back. Each of the coasts had discussion.
Yeah, it was written in the late 60s, actually, and it was... There was a great Roy Acuff song called "Wreck on the Highway" that I always liked, and I just kind of lifted the idea of that and decided that it should be about a truck full of art. And I think there was kind of a weird paranoia at that time in L.A. about New York artists, and there was kind of an equal kind of resentment going on, it seemed like, on the East Coast. This was the climate, anyway, of these upstart California artists. So that's really kind of where the song came from. As far as New Delhi freight train goes, I have been to India, but I haven't been to New Delhi. But that was written while I was watching Jesse James, the true story of Jesse James with Robert Wagner. And I was watching this TV show, and a friend of mine had just come back from Vietnam, and we were watching it together. And it, also the night before, Bobby Kennedy had been killed. And so we're talking about that. We were talking about Gandhi and people laying in front of train tracks, and then we were watching Jesse James, and we were smoking a lot of dope. And but that night, I remember going back into the back room, and that song happened, New Delhi Freight Train. So it kind of those images came together into that song. That's where I think it came from. I'm not sure you ever know where a song really comes from. I think it's always really a mystery. You know, you kind of make it up, which is what I'm doing right now.
maybe just time for one or two more questions.
Just one more.
Thank you. Gosh, just listening this evening and your little story about listening to your music coming in, and it's funny because hearing these songs takes me immediately to where I was listening to them, Juarez. We were driving around the Southwest, and Ghost Ship. I was going back and forth between San Diego a lot, and I wondered if you had any thoughts in terms of your work kind of being transportive, maybe transitional, transcendent? Because I think for a lot of us in the audience today, the music and the art and the theater has really taken us to a lot of places. And tonight, I was just really moved by the tenderness between the two.
That's nice. Thank you, Allison.
Thanks, Allison.
Thank you, Allison. You haven't seen the bad seed. Uh-oh.
I don't know what to say.
Okay. Well, I just want to say thank you both again for being here and really
thank you, Aram.
Loving each other on stage. It's really beautiful.
Thank you, Aram.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.